الحمد لله الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن الناس من يعبد الله على حرف فإن أصابه خير اطمأن به وإن أصابته فتنة انقلب على وجهه خسر الدنيا والآخرة ذلك هو الخسران المبين وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بادروا بالأعمال سبعا ما تنتظرون إلا فقرا منسيا أو غنى متغيا أو مرضا مفسدا أو هرما مفندا أو موتا مجهزا أو الدجال فشر غائب ينتظر أو الساعة والساعة أدهى وأمر أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رواه الترمذي والحاكم في المستدرك أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم respected brothers, elders, my young friends, Alhamdulillah, it is a privilege to be here in this masjid for the first time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the brothers who have invited me and have given me the opportunity to speak on a topic which is very pertinent, very, very important in the time that we are living through. It's a very, very important topic. Remaining steadfast in the times of trials and tribulations. Inshallah, I won't take too much of your time, but in the light of the Quran and Hadith, I would like to share with you the guidance that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the Ummah in regards to how to live in times of fitan. Allama Yusuf Tudyanwi, rahmatullahi alayhi, one of the great scholars of the recent past from Pakistan. He, quoting Shah Waliyullah Muhaddis Dehelwi, rahmatullahi alayhi, used to say, Allah Ta'ala has given this Ummah three things that no one else was given before us. What were the three things? He says, Kalamullah, he says, Rasulullah, and he says, Baytullah. We were given Kalamullah, the Kalam of Allah, the speech of Allah, i.e. the Quran. We were given Rasulullah, the greatest man to set foot on the earth. And number three, we were given Baytullah. And every three of them are connected to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Example, we know in regards to the Kalam of Allah, Allah Ta'ala calls it Ruh. Allah Ta'ala calls it a spirit. In regards to Rasulullah, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And in regards to Baytullah, we know every day 120 blessings are revealed on the Ka'batullah every day. The reason I'm mentioning this is so that we realize Rasulullah, out of his mercy, he has told us everything that will happen until the day of Qiyamah. He has told us everything. To the extent, you will find a hadith on the authority of Sayyiduna Hudhayfa radiyallahu anhu, mentioned by Imam Abu Dawood rahmatullahi alayhi in Sunan Abu Dawood. He says, La adri, I don't know, anasiya ashabi am tanasaw. Did my colleagues genuinely forget, or are they acting as if they forgot? What? He says, Ma min qa'idi fitna ila an tanqadhi ad-dunya إِلَّا وَيَبْلُغُ مَنْ مَعَهُ ثَلَاثُ مِئَةٍ فَصَائِدًا إِلَّا وَقَدْ سَمَّاهُ لَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِاسْمِهِ وَاسْمِ أَبِيهِ وَاسْمِ قَبِيلَتِهِ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, I swear by Allah, I don't know if my colleagues are pretending they don't know, that do they do know, but that anyone that will come in this ummah who will be a corrupt leader, and he will have a following of 300 people or more, but that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us regards his name, his father's name, and the name of his qabila and the tribe from him from where he will come. Imam Al-Qurtubi rahmatullahi alayhi is mentioning the nature of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, we are sometimes ungrateful of the Nabi that we have. We are really, to be honest with you, you know, no other Nabi has told us what our Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has told us. And this is why Allama Sayyid Sulaiman Nadwi rahmatullahi alayhi writes in one of his works, he says, there is no other Nabi that can be a role model besides Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because besides Rasulullah, every other Nabi, maybe from his entire life, you can have 30 to 40 days from his life you can find as a, you know, in a record. How can you follow someone who's only 30 to 40 days you can find? Whereas when it comes to Rasulullah, every single one of his statements is recorded by the Sahaba. You know, we don't realize Imam Al-Qurtubi rahmatullahi mentions, مَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ يُقَرِّبُكُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَيُبَاعِدُكُمْ مِنَ النَّارِ إِلَّا نَبَّأْتُكُمْ بِهِ أو كما قال عليه السلام, Rasulullah says, whatever will take you to Jannah, or whatever will near you to Jannah, and whatever will drive you away from Jahannam, but that I have informed you of everything. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned to us in regards to the fitan. And you know, amongst the many, many specialities of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are many. As mentioned by Allama Jalaluddin Suyuti rahmatullahi in Al-Khasa'is al-Kubra. And many, many other scholars as well. Now, there's just a recent kitab that has come out from Pakistan in four volumes, mentioning only the khususiyat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What were the unique aspects in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Then you will find one of the things that is special to Rasulullah was what mentioned by Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi in Sunan At-Tirmidhi. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ursiltu ila al-khalki kafa. I was sent to the entire mankind, and the teachings of Rasulullah will remain until the day of Qiyamah. So we know after Rasulullah there will be no Nabi. So therefore the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be universal, and they will be of benefit to us until the day of Qiyamah. So now, inshallah, the topic in hand itself, I'd like to mention a few things, because the title, Steadfastness in the Times of Trials and Tribulations. Now, what is fitna? In the Arabic language, it's an Arabic word. It comes from the word fatana yaftinu. The original word, in linguistically, the word fitna means when a goldsmith takes gold and he burns the gold in order to recognize, is it original or is it fake? That action of a goldsmith is known as a fitna. Fatana yaftinu. This is why in the Arabic language, the sunar, the goldsmith, is given the name fattan. The goldsmith is called fattan. The one who recognizes good from bad, original from fake. What happens in a fitna? Mulla Ali Qari rahmatullahi alayhi, he starts his volume number 10, right at the beginning of volume number 10 of his monumental work of Mirqat. Mirqatul Mafatih ala Mishkat al-Masabih. It's a fantastic commentary for the brothers who understand the Arabic language of Mishkat al-Masabih. He writes right at the beginning of volume number 10, he says, Kitabul Fitan, and in the footnotes he says, Al Imtihan wal Ikhtibar bil Baliya. What is a fitna? Fitna is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is it? It is when a calamity comes to you, how do you react and how do you behave? This is a fitna. Now, in the terminology of the ahadith, if you look at the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is deemed to be called a fitna? What is termed as a fitna? Fitna is something, you know, times whereby it will be difficult for you to recognize the truth from the false. It will be hard for you, you know, it'll be hard for you to differentiate between haqq and batil. It will become all mixed up and it will be so difficult to know what was right, what was wrong. Number one. Number two, when you take a dalil which is not a dalil to be a dalil is a fitna. Inshallah, if you can just follow me, inshallah. A dalil which is not a dalil, you take to be a dalil is a fitna. When lies will become common, this will be a fitna. Inshallah, I'm going to mention to you a few things, you know, just inshallah will open our eyes, okay, when we realize what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in regards to the time that will come. So I've told you the meaning of fitna itself, it means a test. Every single thing that happens in your life is a fitna. Everything. Be it good or be it evil. Why? Because Allah says in the Quran, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً. We will test you in times of good, in times of prosperity, in times of adversity, and that will be a fitna for you. If you are enjoying health today, Allah has given you health. This is a test for you. Do you spend that in the remembrance of Allah? You come to the masjid, or you stay at home watching TV and watching the football on a Saturday, and this is why we have so many brothers not coming to the masjid. Why? Because they are too busy watching the football. Allah Ta'ala has given you khayr. Allah has given you children. Allah Ta'ala has given you wealth. How do you react in that wealth? Do you thank Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala? Or do we become like Qarun when we have wealth? This is number one. When you are going through times of adversity and difficulty, how do you react? Are you exercising patience? Are you persevering with the difficult times that Allah Ta'ala has brought on you? So every good that comes in our life, every evil that comes in our life, this is a fitna. But I would like to take you through. You know, what is the purpose of a fitna? Why does Allah Ta'ala bring about a test and trials and tribulations? We have been told in the Quran, if you believe, trials will come on you. Alif Lam Mim, أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون. Do you think just because you have believed, trials will not come to you? No, they will come to you. وهم لا يفتنون. You will be tested. Allah says, ومن الناس من يعبد الله على حرف. There are people who worship Allah Subhanahu wa Taala right on the edge. If the times are good, itma'anna bihi, they are mutma'in with Islam and they are happy with Islam. But when the times are difficult, okay, they are right on the edge, they fall over. Khasira dunya wal akhirah. So what is the goal and what is the purpose of a fitna? Allah says in the surah, in suratul Ankabut, Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. We have tested the people who have gone before you. فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Why? Allah Ta'ala wants to manifest from amongst you who are the truthful and who are the liars in their claim that they are believers. So fitan will come. And why will they come? They will come to try and they will come to test our perseverance, our patience in the times of hardship. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, there will come times of fitna. تعرض الفتن على القلوب كالحصير عودا عودا. You know the way you have strings on a carpet. The way you have strings in a carpet, they are all joined together, intermingling. This is how the fitan will come onto your hearts. كالحصير عودا عودا. Like the strings that you have on a carpet, this is how fitan will come unto you. And then he says, فأي قلب أشربها نكتت فيه نكتة بيضاء وأي قلب أنكرها نكتت فيه نكتة بيضاء حتى تصير على قلبين. There will come a time where the fitnas will be presented on the hearts of man. Whichever heart accepts those fitna, there will come a time every fitna you accept, your heart will become darker and darker and darker until your heart becomes aswad murbad kalkuz mujhiya. Or kama qala alayhi salatu wasalam, your heart will become intensely black, like a vessel that is toppled upside down and there is no good left in it. لا يعرف معروفا ولا ينكر منكرا. It knows no good and it does not recognize no evil. This is one heart. Heart number two, when a fitna comes onto your heart, you reject it. وأي قلب أنكرها نكتت فيه نكتة بيضاء. Allah Ta'ala puts a white mark on your heart to the extent that your entire heart will become white. And this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. This is the time that we are living through. One day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam ashraf al-Nabiyyu sallallahu alaihi wasallam ala utmim min atam al-Madinah. Faqal, ala tarawna ma ara? Do you see what I see? Rasulullah climbed a rooftop, and thereafter addressing the Sahaba, he says, "Do you see what I see?" The Sahaba said, "Messenger of Allah, we don't see what you see." He says, "Inni la ara al-fitan." تَقَعُوا خِلَالَ بُيُوتِكُمْ. I see fitan coming into the center of your homes. And this is what Rasulullah referred to. ثُمَّ تَكُونُ فِتْنَةٌ دُهَيْمًا. There will come a dark fitna. لا تدعو أَحَدًا إِلَّا لَطَمَتْهُ. It will not spare a single individual. And this is, some scholars are of the opinion, this is a reference to the fitna of the TV. It will come in every single home and it will not spare a single home. إِنِّي لَأَرَى الْفِتَنْ تَقَعُ خِلَالَ بُيُوتِكُمْ. And it will not spare and leave anyone. And Rasulullah calls the TV the fitna al-duhayma, the black, dark fitna that will come in amongst you. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بادروا بالأعمال فتن كقطع الليل المظلم. There will come a time where the fitan will come upon you like the parts of the dark night. Every other part or every other part of the night is darker than the first one. Every fitna that will come to you will be darker than the previous fitna. I'd like to share with you, you know, one hadith, it's an amazing hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesizes that when this time comes, you know the times of fitan have started. Well, what did he say? He mentions, obviously there's one hadith I'll mention first, and then he mentions four signs. When you see those four signs, you know you are in a time of fitan. First, the hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in regards to Makkah Mukarrama. What will happen to Makkah Mukarrama that will tell you that you are in a time of fitan and hardship and trial and tribulations, and now you know you are towards the end of time? What did Rasulullah say? إِذَا دُعِيَتْ كَزَائِمْ وَسَاوَى أَبْنِيَتُهَا رُؤُوسَ الْجِبَالِ فَإِنْدَ ذَلِكَ أَزِفَ الْأَمْرِ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. When the time comes that the stomach of Makkah Mukarrama will be cut. The stomach of Makkah, the real meaning is, jab Makkah Mukarrama ka pet chaak kar diya jayega. The stomach and the belly of Makkah Mukarrama will be broken or will be cut. And you see the buildings of Makkah reaching the hilltops of the mountains of Makkah Mukarrama. فَإِنْدَ ذَلِكَ أَزِفَ الْأَمْرَ Then you know it is time of fitan. The muhaddithin were amazed, and they, you know, because 1400 years ago, it is an area that is completely desert, there is nothing there. Rasulullah at that time is saying what is going to happen 1400 years down the line. What did he say? What does it mean by the belly? You know, majority of the muhaddithin, they will just write it means Makkah Mukarrama was a barren land. Allah Ta'ala will bring about their greenery, and there will be nahre, there will be streams there, and there will be water available in Makkah Mukarrama, and this is what they say. But now you can tell what it means. The belly of Makkah Mukarrama are the mountains that are cut open, and you have the tunnels that go right into Makkah Mukarrama and out of Makkah Mukarrama. And this is the belly of Makkah Mukarrama having been cut open. And wasawa abniyatuha ru'us al-jibal. And the abniya and the buildings will reach the rooftops of Makkah Mukarrama, the mountains of Makkah Mukarrama. And you see today, the clock tower stands approximately 150 meters high. Where have they reached? They are reaching the buildings, or you know, the peaks of the mountains of Makkah Mukarrama, the buildings. And this is when Rasulullah said, فَإِنْدَ ذَلِكَ أَزِفَ الْأَمْرِ You know at that time it is time for fitan. There's one kitab, those brothers who understand the Urdu language. It is a fantastic read of Allama Yusuf Lujanvi rahmatullahi has wrote a kitab. It's called Asr-e Hadir Hadith ke Aine mein. In that kitab, he has mentioned all the fitan that will come unto the Ummah until the day of Qiyamah in the light of the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you can find, he's quoted in there one hadith of Sayyidina Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyidina Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman is a sahabi who says, all my other colleagues used to ask Rasulullah regards khayr. Okay, O Messenger of Allah, you know, what will we get if we read namaz, if we give zakat, if we help the poor, if we do this, if we do this. But I was the one who used to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regards evil that will come about in the time. So Sayyidina Hudhayfa quotes the hadith. In one hadith, Rasulullah mentions 72 signs of fitan. And these are all fitan. Example where he mentions, okay, my ummah will destroy salah. Look at the, if you want to know the dindari and the religious nature of a community, look at the people, amount of people in Fajr, and then look at the people that you have in Jumu'ah, and you can see the differentiation. That is a differentiation between, okay, if your locality is good or if your locality is not good. Today I can guarantee you 90% of the ummah have destroyed their salah. If they read a salah, they read four maybe, they don't read Fajr. Or example, you know, you will have people today who you can classify amongst the Muslims as Eid Muslims. Eid. I'm not talking Jumu'ah, I'm talking Eid Muslims. Maybe you can find today Muslims who don't even come for Eid. I know Muslims who are married to non-Muslims and they don't even come to the masjid for Eid prayer. They're married to non-Muslims. A lot of people today, they have the zeal of marrying the white skin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. You know, what I mean, whilst they are non-Muslims, they want to marry them and then they lose everything. They lose everything. You believe me, I know individuals. I came from Blackburn. I was born there. I was raised there. I came from Blackburn. I know individuals in Blackburn who got married to non-Muslim girls. They have three children. And every single one of them is now goes to church and their names are non-Muslim names. They don't even know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't know nothing at all. But anyway, one of the things Rasulullah mentioned was, Salah will be destroyed by my ummah. And today we are going through that time. Zakat will be taken as a tax. Lies will become halal. You tell me lies have not become halal? Lies will become halal. Women, you will have singing girls in the homes of Muslims. Do you not have that? How many people today, wallah, you must forgive me, Alhamdulillah, I don't have a TV, but I know the things that happen. Because we have students that tell us as well. Today, I think you have the X Factor. Is this not singing girls that will come into your home? This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. How many years ago? 1400 years ago. You will have this, you will have this, you will have this. You will have people that will wear silk. The greed for gold will become common. The greed for gold will become common. Interest will become halal. Interest will become halal, meaning the people will take interest to be halal. And then he continues, he says, you will find women who are wearing clothes, but they will be naked. Especially in the summer, do you see that? Absolutely, 100%. I was quoting to you a few of the fitan that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned that will come about. Rasulullah says, the fitan that will come about, كَوَقْعِ الْمَطَرِ. They will come like the rainfall. You know, how does rain fall? One drop after the other, it is continuous. In the same way, it will be the same when it comes to fitna, there will be continuous fitna. In fact, to the extent, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, one fitna will follow another, another, another. They will be so severe that Rasulullah will say, it says, a person who gets involved in those fitna, he will say, هَذِهِ مُهْلِكَتِي. This fitna will destroy me. Until then another fitna comes, he'll say, now this will destroy me. To the extent that a person will come to a time where Rasulullah says, times of fitna will come upon my ummah to the extent where a person will go past a grave. حَتَّى يَمُرَّ الرَّجُلْ عَلَى الْقَبْرِ فَيَتَمَرَّغُ عَلَيْهِ. He will roll over the grave. And physically a person will roll over the grave and he will speak to the person in the grave and he will say, Ya layta makana sahibi hadha al-qabr. It would have been nice if I was in the place of the person who is in the grave here and I was dead and he was in my place. This is how difficult the times will become towards the end of time. Now inshallah I would like to take you through only five fitan. Only five. I only want to focus on five. Every individual here will know what I am speaking about and every fitan you can put in the category of these five. And inshallah I'll mention the five fitan. Thereafter I'll mention the ilaj and what is the role of a Muslim in times of fitan and difficulties and tribulations. And then inshallah the importance of istiqamah and I will finish. So we've mentioned here what the word fitna means. We've mentioned here what is the purpose of a fitna. It is a test before a person dies during his lifetime. It is a test of our iman. We've mentioned the fact that Rasulullah prophesied hardships and difficulties will come. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has prophesied everything. Now inshallah we say five fitan that I would like to focus on. Fitna number one, and this is one of the greatest fitan today in the ummah. It's known as fitnatul mal, the fitna of wealth. Innama amwalukum wa awladukum fitna. Your amwal, your wealth and your children are a test for you. How many people today have failed in this test that Allah Ta'ala has put on every individual. Allah says in the Holy Quran, in Surah Al-Zukhruf, in the 25th juz of the Quran, وَلَوْلَا أَن يَكُونَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً لَجَعَلْنَا لِمَن يَكْفُرُ بِالرَّحْمَنِ لِبُيُوتِهِمْ سُقُفًا مِّن فِضَّةٍ وَمَعَارِجَ عَلَيْهَا يَزْهَرُونَ وَزُخْرُفًا. Allah says, if it was not the fear of the fact that people will all become kafir, I would have given every kafir everything in his home made of gold and silver. But I fear if I give the kafir gold and silver in his home, everyone else, the Muslims, will see them, okay, they have so much wealth, and they will also become kafir as well. Well, what did Rasulullah say? إِنَّ لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ فِتْنَةٍ وَفِتْنَةُ أُمَّتِي الْمَالِ. Every nation has a fitna and a test upon them, and the greatest fitna of my ummah is al-mal, is wealth. Today, on the basis of wealth, you tell me how many people have sold their religion. And this is what Rasulullah prophesied in the hadith. It's a beautiful hadith. يُصْبِحُ الرَّجُلُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا وَيُمْسِي مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بِعَرَضٍ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, a person will wake up in the morning, he'll be a believer, and in the evening he'll be a kafir. In the evening he'll be a believer, in the morning he'll be a kafir. What will he do? He will sell his religion بِعَرَضٍ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا for a mere paltry gain of the dunya. For, you know, today, how many people go into a bank in order to apply for a mortgage? Apply for a mortgage at 12 o'clock in the afternoon. They come home 5 o'clock very, very happy, that they do not realize they have waged war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Today, you will not believe it. Today, people do not read Jumu'ah namaz because of work. They say, you know, the boss will not allow us, okay, to take leave, and you know, we have no choice. One of the greatest fitnas of Dajjal will also be the fitna of wealth. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioning the fitna of Dajjal, what did Rasulullah say in regards to Dajjal? كَانَ يَعْرِفُ السُّوقَ. Dajjal will know the marketplace. Dajjal will know what is happening in the marketplace. And you know how? Everyone, the world today, wants everyone to run their lives on the plastic card. And in this way, every transaction you are doing is monitored. Ideally, you want to do everything cash, you don't want to do anything on card. And then obviously, you know, a lot of people get involved in the fact of interest as well when they are involved in the cards. So the fitna of wealth is one of the greatest fitnas upon this ummah. فَوَاللَّهِ مَا الْفَقْرَ أَخْشَى عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَكِنِّي أَخَافُ أَن تُبْسَطَ عَلَيْكُمُ الدُّنْيَا فَتَنَافَسُوهَا كَمَا تَنَافَسُوهَا فَتُهْلِكَكُمْ كَمَا أَهْلَكَتْهُمْ. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, I don't fear that you will become poverty stricken after me. I don't fear that. But what I do fear is Allah Ta'ala will open up the dunya for you, and you will race after the dunya. Recently in India, in someone who I know very, very close to our family, a brother killed a brother inside the masjid on a Jumu'ah day. You know why? For wealth. He brought a massive knife and he put it into the back of his brother. This is a saga brother. This is a real brother. On Jumu'ah day in the Jami' Masjid of the village, there was blood all over the place, and it's ruined the entire family. Entire families have ruined. Why? Because of wealth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, you know, today you will see people selling their religion. You will not believe it. It is shocking, really. It is absolutely shocking for how much people are selling their deen. One of my ustads who recently came from India. You know, you have to go to the British Embassy to get the visa to come here. So he went for a visitor's visa. You will not believe, whilst he was waiting in the line, someone told him, okay, if they give you problems in granting you visa, there is a line you can declare yourself to be a Qadiani and they will give you visa. He says, this is what I do. When I want to go to England, the poor person says, when I want to go to England and I get difficult time, I say, I'm a Qadiani. And I get the visa. Today people are selling their deen. Why? To come to this country. And you know, I don't have to tell you what type of fitna related to wealth we have within our community. How many Muslim people today are involved in interest dealings? There's only two things. in the entire 6,216 verses of the Quran and the hundreds of thousands of ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will find there's only two things regards which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you do this, then I am at war against you. Number one, interest dealings. And number two, if you trouble a friend of Allah, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. If you trouble a friend of mine, then I wage war against you. And this is why when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw an individual eating with the left hand, the hadith mentioned by Imam Muslim, when he saw him eating with the left hand, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to eat with the right. He says, I can't. What did Rasulullah say? لَسْتَطَعْتَ. May you not be able to eat with your right hand. May you not. See, you might ask a question here. Rasulullah never used to take revenge. Why did Rasulullah make a bad dua against him? Why did Rasulullah curse him? May you never be able to. The Sahaba say, for the rest of that person's life, he could raise his hands to his mouth, he could raise it, but he could never raise it to eat. When it came to eating, he could never raise his hands with food to his mouth. His entire life, he had to eat with his left hand. Why? Because if Rasulullah had not taken revenge, Allah would have taken revenge directly himself. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, one day, he was sat and one youngster came, 26 years old. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi was in his late 60s, because Imam Sahib rahmatullahi passed away at the age of 70. He was in his late 60s. His mother was still alive at the age of 90 something, late 80s and 90s. The youngster came, 26 years old, and says, I want to marry your mother. He says to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, I want to marry your mother. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi says, my mother is intellectual. She knows what is good for her, what is not good for her. But obviously it was a mockery of the Imam. The person left. Imam Sahib rahmatullahi told the people who were around him, if someone can take revenge, if someone can go and take revenge, no one did. That person went a few more steps. He fell down and he died. Mar gaya. And that's why it is famous in the biography of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, the sabr of Abu Hanifa killed an individual. The sabr of Imam Abu Hanifa killed an individual. Meaning, because Imam Abu Hanifa did not say anything in revenge, in retaliation to what the person had said, mocking Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for friends of Allah, Allah ta'ala takes revenge himself. So the fitna, the first fitna of the ummah is the fitna of wealth. You know, for everything on the day of Qiyamah, you'll be asked one question. You'll be asked, what did you do with your age? What did you do with your life? But when it comes to wealth, Allah Ta'ala will ask you two questions. مِنْ أَيْنَكْ تَسَبْتَ وَفِيمَ أَنْفَقْتَ. Where did you earn the money from? And where did you spend the money? There are two questions. فَأَعِدَّ لِنَفْسِكَ جَوَابًا لِلسُؤَالَيْنَ. It is our duty to prepare your answers for those questions that are to come. And I'd like to give you an example. Two examples from the Holy Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions regards fitnatul mal. One is kiltal sahibul jannatain, who is mentioned in Suratul Kahf. وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا رَجُلَيْنَ. In Suratul Kahf, Allah ta'ala mentions regards the person who had two gardens. He was a non-Muslim, and the person who had nothing, he was a believer. What did the person who had the two gardens, he was arrogant, what did the person who had nothing, what did he say to him? قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ أَكَفَرْتَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَكَ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. Are you going to reject Allah who created you from soil? Are you going to reject Allah? So what do you understand? From the fitan of wealth, how do you save yourself? Through sahih iman. If your aqidah is correct, if your iman is correct, if you have a proper tawheed and you recognize this wealth is nothing. Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi, the great student of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, used to say, you know, Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi used to go into the gathering of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi. He was very, very poor. Imam Abu Yusuf was very, very poor. He used to go into the gathering of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, and his mother used to say to Imam Abu Hanifa, you have spoilt my son. Okay, he doesn't earn anything. He said, you know what, you mustn't worry. Whatever he will earn, I will give him free of charge. And then Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi says, I can see the time when this son of yours will be presented with a glass of Faluda by the king Harun al-Rashid, by the king of his time. And that is what happened. he became the Qazi. Imam Abu Yusuf Rahmatullahi became Qazi al-Quzat in Iraq in the time of Harun al-Rashid Rahmatullahi. And Faluda, I'm sure the Faluda drink was brought in front of Harun al-Rashid Rahmatullahi, and he says, first give it to Imam Abu Yusuf Rahmatullahi. And tears comes to his eyes, tears come to his eyes, and says, this was a prophecy and this is what my ustad told me if I remain engrossed in knowledge. So al-iman al-sahih, al-aqidatu al-sahihah, al-tawheed is what will save you from the fitna of wealth. And I recommend every brother who's sitting here to read the fantastic work of Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak rahmatullahi alayhi. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, Kitab al-Zuhd of Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak was born in 118 and passed away in 181. It's a fantastic work, everyone should read it. Or if you can't read that, read any book of hadith in which you find Kitab al-Riqaq. Kitab al-Riqaq means those riwayat that will soften your heart because there is a remembrance of Qiyamah. Tomorrow you will die, Sikandar the great king. Sikandar. You know, when he was passing away, he was a king, one of the greatest kings to have lived from the Muslims. When he was passing away, he said, when you take me to the graveyard, leave my hands outside my janazah. And when you take me into the graveyard, then you can put my hands back into the janazah. The people said, why? He says, so people know this king came empty-handed and he is going empty-handed. He came into the world empty-handed and you will go empty-handed as well. So the first one, if you have iman, Allah Ta'ala will safeguard you from the times of fitan. The second example, and this is, you know, this is something, this is an eye-opener for everyone. The example of Qarun. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala gave him so much, maybe no one will have nowadays. No one. مَا إِنَّ مَفَاتِحَهُ لَتَنُوءُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ أُولِي الْقُوَّةِ Allah Ta'ala gave him so much that the treasures were so much of Qarun, the keys to carry the treasure, you needed a group to just carry his keys. Not the treasure, just the keys. Okay, this is how much treasure he had. What did he say? إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي This is from my own know-how that I have my wealth. But what does Allah say in regards to when, you know, when Fir'aun was, Qarun was told, أحسن إليك كما, sorry, أحسن كما أحسن الله إليك. You should do good the way Allah has done good with you. Do you know how this wealth came to you? It was because of the health Allah gave you, you have wealth. If you did not have intellect, if a person was born mental, would you have been able to attain the wealth? If Allah gave you no health, would you be? If Allah Ta'ala gave you no sihat, will you be working today and earning money? If Allah Ta'ala had made an individual crippled and disabled, maybe he would not have been able. So he was told, أحسن كما أحسن الله إليك. And then he was told, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Don't forget your share from the dunya. You must take your share from the dunya when you go into the grave. Some commentators of the Holy Quran beautifully say, you know what that means? What is your share of the dunya that you will take with you when you go into the grave? Huwa al-kafan. Huwa al-kafan. It is a kafan, that's the only thing you will take. When you came into this world, as soon as you came from the womb of the mother, there was a cloth put over you, there was a shroud put over you in order to cover you. And this is the only shroud that will cover you when you go into the graveyard. يَتْبَعُ الْمَيِّتْ ثَلَاثٍ Three things follow the mayyit when you go from this world into your grave. Rasulullah says, يَرْجِعُ إِثْنَانْ وَيَبْقَى وَاحِدٍ Two will come back and only one will remain. Your wealth comes with you. Your family comes with you. And your amal comes with you. It's only your amal that will stay with you in your grave and say, أَنَا عَمَلُكَ الصَّالِحِ If your amal is good, then inshallah a person will be able to remain steadfast in the questioning of the grave. So number one is the fitna of wealth. What I wanted to say in the example of Qarun, what does Allah say? قال الذين يريدون الحياة الدنيا. The people, what did the people who just wanted the world, what did they say? يا ليت لنا مثل ما أوتي قارون. If we were given the same wealth as Qarun. But look what Allah says. What is a savior for you? وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ وَيْلَكُمْ ثَوَابُ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ لِّمَنْ آمَنَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا If you want to be safeguarded from the fitna of wealth, you will have to attain true Islamic knowledge. So through number one, through knowledge, and number two, through al-iman, al-sadiq, al-aqidah, al-sahiha, al-tawheed, you will be able to preserve yourself. That's fitna number one. Fitna number two is an-nisa. And I don't have to tell you in the summer. I don't have to tell you what happens in the summer. Basically, the summer has started. You know, in the last few days, when you go outside from here, whatever you have attained inside the masjid, if you utilize your eyes wrong, you have lost everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, where Allah ta'ala mentions regards shahwat and the desires upon man, what does Allah mention first? زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ والبنين والقناطير. Allah Ta'ala says, the حب الشهوات and the love of desires has been beautified for mankind. And at the forefront is من النساء. نساء and women are the greatest في فتنة. This is why we have marriage in Islam. This is why a person should get married. Unfortunately, people are married and they still have, I don't know, it's very, very unfortunate. You know, one of the signs of the time of fitna Rasulullah mentioned, talaq will become common. Talaq will become common. The other day there was a nikah in Leicester. The boy and the girl, the bride and the groom are on the motorway. They're coming back. They stop at the service station and it was a Lamborghini. Now the bride says, give me a ride. The husband said, no, because you're not insured. You will not believe at the station he gave her talaq. He gave her talaq and he left her there at the station on the motorway and he came back himself. Abi, recently there was a talaq on the stage, straight after the nikah. You know, just very, very recently, not too long ago, on the stage, the husband and the wife, the bride and the groom, they got into a conversation regards a holiday. Okay, we booked the holiday, when are we going for the holiday? So the bishara, the groom said, we're going after 2 days. He said, why not tomorrow? The bride says, why are we not going tomorrow? So he says, because we have some mihman from South Africa. So this is why we're going to stay with them for 1 day. You will not believe, they got into an argument on the stage and he divorced her on the stage. Talaq will become common. This is also one of the signs that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. Anyway, an-nisa, women. What did Rasulullah say? مَا تَرَكْتُ بَعْدِي فِتْنَةً أَضَرَّ عَلَى الرِّجَالِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. I have not left behind a fitna that is worse and dangerous and more harmful for men than women. This hadith is a beautiful hadith where Rasulullah says, إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا حُلْوَةٌ خَضِرَةٌ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مُسْتَخْلِفُكُمْ فِيهَا فَيَنْظُرْ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَاءَ. Beware of the fitna of women that you have around you. You know, when next time you go outside and you have the desire to look at haram and to look at a lady, just remember Allah Ta'ala has given you the lesson of tawheed in your eyes. The lesson of tawheed you learn from your eyes. One of my ustad used to say so beautifully, he says, Allah Ta'ala has given you 2 eyes. But at one time you can only focus on one thing. If I am looking at Brother Sayyid in front of me, I can't look at right and left. I will only be focusing on one. So you have 2 eyes, but Allah Ta'ala has given us the lesson of tawheed in the 2 eyes. You are reading from a kitab, you are reading from the Quran, you can only read 1 page. You can't read 2 pages simultaneously, you can't look at 2 pages simultaneously. Otherwise you will strain your eyes. It's only you can focus on one thing. Why? You have 2 eyes, but it's there to, Allah Ta'ala is teaching you tawheed. In everything you see, there is a lesson of tawheed. And this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us these eyes. Hazrat Mufti Taqi Uthmani, Shaykh al-Islam, the great Mufti of Pakistan and the former Chief Justice of Pakistan, he says, you know the veins that you have connected to the eyes, every time you blink, they travel 7 miles. Every time you blink. Not only in the eyes you have been given a lesson of tawheed, but the lesson of the qudrat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to see haram with that eye that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you to look at halal when you can look at halal. You lower your gaze and inshallah you see the taste of ibadah that you realize when you come to the masjid. You go outside, you go to the marketplaces, and then straight away you come into the masjid and you read salah, and then you see the situation in your salah. You will just see miniskirts. May Allah forgive us. And on the other hand, you come directly, example, you know, you've read the Quran at home, directly you come to the masjid, and then you see the focus that you have within salah. So the fitna of women, how do you safeguard yourself from the fitna of women? That is so beautiful. In the story of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, what does Allah say? وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا. When Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam reached the peak of his age, we gave him hikmah, we gave him knowledge. After that verse, what does Allah say? وَرَاوَدَتْهُ الَّتِي هُوَ فِي بَيْتِهَا عَنْ نَفْسِهِ وَغَلَّقَتِ الْأَبْوَابِ. The lady in whose house Yusuf alayhi salam was residing enticed him towards evil. And she not only closed the doors, she bolted the doors. وَغَلَّقَتْ in the Arabic language means to lock the doors and to bolt. وَغَلَّقَتْ, what did Yusuf alayhi salam say at the time? قَالْ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ, I seek the protection of Allah. Why? See, Allah Ta'ala says, because of the knowledge we gave him, he is able to say, Ma'ad Allah. At the times of fitna of wealth, at the time of fitna of women, how do you save yourself? You educate yourself. You try and strengthen your iman. As Allah says in Surah Al-Asr, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَامِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. The third fitna. The third fitna that will come about in the ummah, as mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is known as fitnatu takfir wal harj. And this is the time that we're living through at the moment. Rasulullah said there will come a time where a person will very easily call another person ya kafir. Ayyuma rajulin qala li akhihi ya kafir faqad ba'a bihi ahaduhuma. If someone calls another person a kafir and he does not deserve it, then at least one of them is a kafir. Today, the fitna of takfir, I don't know, you know, I don't want to insult anyone. The Islamic State, the group, Rasulullah is prophesizing here, the mentality of the Khawarij will come back into the Ummah. The mentality of the Khawarij. Khawarij means those people who used to say, if you do a major sin, you become a kafir. The Islamic State, one defector has wrote a tweet. He's tweeted that the IS is a takfiri group. They call everyone kafir. Recently, they took some prisoners from Syria and they were smoking and they said, you are kafir. So you know, kafir on everything. There will come a time where people will brand one another kafir. So this is fitnatul takfir. And the second one is fitnatul haraj. Fitnatul haraj means the killings will become so widespread. Rasulullah says, يَأْتِي عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٍ لَا يَدْرِي الْقَاتِلْ فِي مَقَتَلْ وَلَا الْمَقْتُولْ فِي مَقُتِلْ. Or كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ سَلَاتُ وَسَلَامُ. There will come a time of fitna upon the ummah where killings will become so common, the killer does not know why he killed, and the one who was killed does not know why they were killed. Today, Bishara, how many Muslims and brothers and sisters of ours have died in Iraq? They don't know why they've been killed. How many in Syria? How many in Afghanistan? How many in Yemen? And you name it. Iran, Iraq, you name it. How many people have died? They do not know. You know, just a recent example of the German Wings plane. 150 people in the Alps. Do they know why they were killed? But you know, mashallah, alhamdulillah, the pilot was not a Muslim. Alhamdulillah. You know, in India, in one of the recent papers in India, you know what they said? He had recently converted to Muslim, to Islam. They have to find a link. And this is the next sign I would like to take you on to. So anyway, this is fitnatul haraj and fitnatul qatl. Today we are living through that time. The fourth fitna that Rasulullah mentioned was, you know, it's known as fitnatu inqilabil mafahim. And this is a very interesting one. There will come a time where values will change. Values will change. The understanding of things will completely change. In fact, Rasulullah says, يَأْتِي عَلَى النَّاسَ سَنَوَاتٌ خَدَّاعَاتٌ. Deceptive years will come to you. there will come upon you many, many deceptive years, jahan dhoka hoga. What will be the time? يُصَدَّقَ فِيهَا الْكَاذِبُ وَيُكَذَّبَ فِيهَا الصَّادِقُ وَيُخَوَّنُ فِيهَا الْأَمِينَ وَيُؤَمَّنُ فِيهَا الْخَائِنُ أو كما قال وَيَتَكَلَّمُ فِيهِ الرُّوَيْبِضَةُ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. There will come a time where there will be complete deception rife in the community. A liar will be classified as a truthful individual. Is that not what we're going through today? A liar will be classified as a truthful individual, and the truthful will be classified as a liar. The person who you can trust will be classified as a khain, khiyanat karne wala, dhoka baz, deceptive individual, and the other way around. Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala mentions there will come a time where the good will be classified as evil and the evil will be classified as good. And Rasulullah says that will be the time wa yatakallamu fihi ar-ruwaybida. The Sahaba said, Umm Salama wallah, man ar-ruwaybida? Who are the ruwaybida? Rasulullah said, ar-rajul at-tafih yatakallam fi amr al-amma. You will have a person who has absolutely no knowledge. He will talk in regards to the matters of the people, meaning yufti al-jahil. You will be living in a time where the fatwa you will gain will be from a jahil. The jahil will give you the fitna. Today, the time we are living in, you know, to be gay is to be straight. It's fine. You know, this is a time we are living in where you have to say, this is what I said, inqilabul mafahim. Values will change. You know, till today, I'm sure you know in the Bible, in the Torah, what Allah Ta'ala has mentioned in regards to homosexuality, what Allah Ta'ala has mentioned. But what did Rasulullah say? What will happen? You will have inqilabul mafahim. Allah says in the Holy Quran in regards to Fir'aun. What does Fir'aun say? Dharuni aqtul Musa. Leave me, I want to kill Musa. Why? Why you want to kill Musa? Inni akhafu an yubaddila deenakum aw an yuzhira fil ardi al fasad. I think he will change you your religion. Musa will change your religion for you. And Musa will be, you know, spreading corruption in the land. You know, subhanallah, you say, Musa alayhi salam yufsid fil ard, wa fir'aun yuslih fil ard. Fir'aun is doing islah, and Musa alayhi salatu salam is doing ifsad. This is what you call inqilabul mafahim. Values will change. The time that we are living through, this is that time. Rasulullah mentioned the fifth fitna, fitnatu ad-du'at ila ad-dalal. You will have leaders who will lead you towards corruption, towards deviation. I'd like to share with you one incident. I don't need to go into that. You know, the Muslim Prevent leader, the Prevent team leader in Newham is a Muslim. And he is so corrupted. Allah Ta'ala maaf kare, I don't know, wallahu alam, what is the state of his iman? He's advising the government, and today, you know, all the counter-terrorism, the CTS bill, etc., they are one of the advisors on that bill. Muslims are bringing it about on Muslims. This is known as fitnatu du'at. You know, Sayyidina Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, radiyallahu anhu, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, قَدْ جَاءَنَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا الْخَيْرِ. Through yourself, O Messenger of Allah, Allah has given us Islam. After this khayr, will there be shar? Rasulullah said, yes. After the khayr, there will come shar. And then he says, after that shar, will there be khayr? He said, yes. And then eventually there will come a time, du'atun ala abwaabi jahannam. You will have individuals that will call you towards the doors of jahannam. And I would like to just leave you with one example. Ibn Ashur, rahmatullahi alayhi, he's one of the greatest commentators of the Quran in the recent past. He passed away, he's a Tunisian scholar who was born in 1879 and passed away in 1973. So just recently passed away. He's wrote a tafsir in 15,000 pages, 30 volumes, 500 pages every volume. Ibn Ashur, rahmatullahi, he was known for standing up against the leaders of his time. In his time, one of the leaders was Bourguiba. He was a president of his time in Tunisia. He forced him to write a fatwa that it is fine that if a person is working, he does not need to fast during the month of Ramadan. If you are fasting, because it will decrease productivity. It makes you weaker, okay? You can't produce it the way you are. So therefore, if a person does not fast because of his work, it is fine. So he stood up and he said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam, kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum, la'allakum tattaqoon. Sadaqa Allahu al-azim, wa kadaba burghiba. Burghiba is a liar. Allah has mentioned the truth. And Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam. So these kind of leaders will come upon the ummah as well. Now, what is the stance of a Muslim at times of difficulty and at times of fitan? What do we do? Inshallah, I'll just point them out, inshallah, and inshallah, I'll finish on this. Number one, first and foremost, a person has to do, strengthen your iman, al-aqidah. In that case, inshallah, read any, you know, books on al-aqidah, whereby you can realize what is iman, what is true iman, okay, what will take me out of the fold of Islam. So strengthen your iman, as I mentioned in the story of the person in Surah Kahf, and also in regards to the wealth of Qarun, etc. So number one, you strengthen your iman, number one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, it's so beautiful. You know, unfortunately today we don't read the Quran. If we read the Quran, we don't understand the Quran. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. Allah Ta'ala will keep you steadfast, the believers, Allah will keep them steadfast. Through what? بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ. Through the qawl, which is thabit, which is a reference to La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. But what is interesting, where does Allah place that verse? Prior to that, Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتْ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ وَمَثَلُ كَلِمَةٍ خَبِيثَةٍ كَشَجَرَةٍ أُجْتُثَّتْ مِنْ فَوْقِ الْأَرْضِ مَا لَهَا مِنْ قَرَارٍ. The example of the good word and the bad word, i.e. كلمة الإيمان and كلمة الكفر. And straight after that, he says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Look at the example of Sayyidina Bilal. No matter what he went through, but what does he say? Ahad, ahad. Why? Because of his iman. And because of the words, those words at the time of fitan, you know, at the times of difficulty, he remains steadfast on his iman. This is why in the tariq and history of Islam, there's only one person who stands on the mimbar, who stands on the roof of the Kaaba and gives azan from the roof of the Kaaba. You won't find any other individual in tariq. Three great Africans have passed in the Ummah. Three great Africans have passed. Number one, Sayyidina Luqman. Luqman Hakim, who's mentioned in the Quran, was from Africa, from Sudan, according to Imam Qurtubi, rahmatullahi. Then you have Sayyidina Bilal Habashi. And number three, the great Tabi'i, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, who was a student of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, born in 45 AH and passed away in 95 AH. So these three great Africans, Sayyidina Bilal, Ahad, Ahad. Because at times of difficulty, he raised the banner of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the words of Allah. Allah allowed him in times of prosperity now, when Rasulullah is entered Makkah Mukarrama as a victorious individual, you can climb the roof of the Kaaba and give azan from there. And what did, you know, when Hiraqla, in Hadith Hiraqla, the long hadith in Bukhari, right in the beginning, where Hiraqla questioned Abu Sufyan. He says, هَلْ يَرْتَدُّ أَحَدٌ عَنْ دِينِهِ. After believing in Muhammad, does anyone turn to apostasy? Does anyone become murtad? He says, no. And what did Hiraqla say? إِذَا خَالَطَ بَشَاشَتُهُ الْقُلُوبَ كَذَلِكَ الْإِيمَانِ. This is a state of iman as well, where once it goes into the heart, a person never turns away from it. So number one, strengthen your iman. At times of difficulty, at times of hardship, a person must become a strong Muslim. How do you strengthen your iman? Inna al-iman yazidu bit-ta'at wa yanqus bil-ma'asi. Iman increases because of spending time in the remembrance of Allah, being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and iman decreases because of sins. So this is what we have to avoid, and this is what we have to do. That's number one. Number two, the second way, hold steadfast to the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, Shaykh al-Hind rahmatullahi alayhi. I'm sure a lot of the brothers would have heard the name here. Shaykh al-Hind rahmatullahi alayhi is called Allama Mahmoodul Hasan Deobandi. Rahmatullah Ali, one of the great scholars of Deoband, he was imprisoned by the English in the Mediterranean Sea in an island called Malta. In an island called Malta. In 1914, for about 4 to 5 years, he came back to Deoband in 1918 or 1919. Sheikh Al-Hind Rahmatullah Ali, I'll just like to share with you here. He says, itne chalaag hai ye angrez, they are so, so crafty. If you have two fishes fighting in the ocean, you know it's the hand of the English. This is what he used to say. These are very, very, you know, وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودِ وَلَن نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. Don't you know we are becoming like them? Do you think they won't become like us and we become like them? What kind of a mentality? Allah Ta'ala gave us gold. You know, our example is what Sheikh Sa'di Rahmatullah used to say. Sheikh Sa'di Rahmatullah says, a child when he was a very young child, 4 or 5 years old, the mother gave him a ring made of gold with a diamond on top. He goes to the market, he goes to play, and someone finds him and says, you know, you got a very, very nice ring. Okay, you got a good ring, but you know, you can't eat that. I'll give you chocolate. So he gives him a chocolate. So he takes the chocolate and he gives the ring. He says, this is our example. Sheikh Sa'di Rahmatullah says, this is our example as the Ummah. Allah gave us gold. And we are after soil. Allah gave us gold. There is what we have is no one has. Brothers, you believe me, we have what no one else has. So Sheikh Al-Hind Rahmatullah Ali says when he came back from Malta, you know what he said in Deoband? He says, I've learned in the jail two things what I did not know before. I learned in the jail what I did not know before. I learned two things. And look what he says. This is an eye-opener. He says, I learned in jail the goal of the people who are non-Muslim is what? They want to sever the connection of the masses from their ulama, from their scholars, number one. And number two, they want to sever the connection of the ummah from the Quran. He says there is only one ilaj. There's only one cure for that. Establish durus of the Quran in every single masjid in India. And then you will see the people will become connected to the ulama, because the person who will conduct the dars will be an alim. And they will become connected to the Quran as well. And this is the best way to connect the people to the Quran at times of fitan. This is the best way to safeguard yourself. Allah SWT says in the Quran, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنِ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدَةً. Allah says, كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. The people are asking, why did Allah not reveal the Quran in one go upon Muhammad? Right at once, all the whole Quran together. Allah says, no, we didn't. Why? Because we wanted to keep your heart firm onto the path through the Quran. So it'll be through the Quran that you become firm on the path of Allah and through the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and al-khulafa' al-rashidin al-mahdiyin. Alaykum bi sunnati wa sunnati al-khulafa' al-rashidin al-mahdiyin. Hadith mentioned by Imam al-Tirmizi, sataftariqu ummati ala 73. My ummah will deviate into 73 groups. Or will go astray, or will part in 73 groups. Oh, every single one of them fin nar illa wahida. Ma ana alayhi wa ashabi is the jama'at which is on the true path. So number two, hold steadfast with the Quran. Number three. So number one, can we recap? Iman, mashallah. Strengthen your iman and your aqidah, and also along with that knowledge as well. And number two, the Quran and the sunnah. Number three, التأسي بالأنبياء وبمن سبقنا من الصالحين. Follow in the examples of the Anbiya عليهم الصلاة والسلام who went before us. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relates many, many stories to the Rasulullah in the Holy Quran. Why? وَكُلَّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. We relate to you the stories of the Anbiya. Why? In order to keep your heart firm on the straight path. You know, some scholars have put it so beautifully. They say, if you see a Muslim, if a Muslim is wrongly imprisoned, he should remember the story of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So we have an example for everyone to follow. Read the stories of the Anbiya alayhi salam. If a person is ill and in a very, very dangerous illness, let him take the example of Sayyidina Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam. If a person is not having children after making dua to Allah Ta'ala for such a long time, Some people, you know, they get depressed. Why? Because they don't have children. Haji Farooq Sahab, alhamdulillah, one great scholar used to say, very, very beautifully. He says, in this country, to have children is a rahmat of Allah, and to not have children is also a ni'mat of Allah. To have children is a rahmat of Allah, and to not have children is also a ni'mat and a blessing of Allah. Because how you know they might have gone astray? How you know they might have took you astray? How do you know they might have become your hell? Why did Allah Ta'ala order Sayyidina Khadr to kill that young boy? Because Allah says, فَأَرَدْنَا, we wanted to kill him. Why? Because there was a possibility he would have taken his parents into kufr. This is the decree of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. If you don't have children, remember the example of the Anbiya alayhi salam who didn't have children. Sayyidina Zakariya alayhi salam did not have a child until very, very old age. إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبة ولم أكن بدعائك ربي شقيا إلى آخره. And if you are ever in a land where no one knows you, and you are example in Guantanamo Bay, and the world has forgotten about you, what do you do? Remember the example of Sayyidina Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam في بطن الحوت, when he was in the belly of the fish. He was in a land where no one knew him. Okay, he was absolutely lost. Okay, remember the examples. Sayyidina Khabbab came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah was leaning against the Kaaba. And he said, oh, Messenger of Allah, ala tad'u lana. You're not going to make dua. The times are so difficult upon us. Will you not make dua against the kuffar of Makkah? Rasulullah was leaning. He stood up properly. He sat down and he said, oh Khabbab, come. He sat down and you know what he said? The people who came before you, they used to dig a hole for them. They used to be placed in there. An axe used to be brought, and it was placed في مفرق الرأس, in the center of the head, and then a person was cut into two pieces. Those halat have not come unto you yet. You persevere, and inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will bring you good times. So that is also another thing as well that you do at times of fitan. Read the stories of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. And number four, and number five, inshallah, I'll just finish on this, inshallah. Number four is dua. You have to resort to dua at the times of fitan. And dua that is mentioned in the Quran, Rabbana afrigh alayna sabra wa thabbit aqdamana. O Allah, pour down upon us sabr and perseverance. And O Allah, وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا, keep our feet firm on the straight path. وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. So this is a dua. The dua mentioned by Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Shahr ibn Hawshib rahmatullahi says, I asked Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala anha, what was the dua that Rasulullah used to make frequently when he was with you? Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala says, he used to make a dua very frequently. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O the one who turns hearts, keep my heart firm on your path. Because this is very, very important, especially at the time when Dajjal will come. So this is another dua. Another dua mentioned in the ahadith, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ بِعِبَادِكَ فِتْنَةً فَاقْبِضْنِي إِلَيْكَ غَيْرَ مَفْتُونَ. Oh Allah, when you intend to bring a trial upon your servants, bring me and take me back to you without me being tested in those fitan. So these are du'as that we should make at times of difficulty, because du'a, inshallah, is the greatest hatiyar and the weapon of a believer. Ad-du'a silahul mu'min. Ad-du'a silahul mu'min. And the last one, and this is very, very important, the last two, inshallah. Al-i'tizaz bil-Islam. You must remain proud of your Islam. Don't think, you know, everyone else has everything, we have nothing. No, we have everything. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud used to say, Allah, what, you know, Allah has given you the Quran and Allah has given you the Sunnah. If you think someone else has been given something better than you, then you have degraded something that Allah Ta'ala honored. You know, if you think your izzah, your izzah and your honor and your dignity and your reverence is in your car, is in your clothes, is in your wealth, then you are very, very deeply mistaken. فَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَكِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Izzah belongs to Allah, to the Messenger, and to the mu'mineen. Do you remember the case? Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu anhu, in 16 AH, when Muslims conquered Baytul Maqdis, the Jews denied, we will not give the key to anyone but Umar ibn al-Khattab. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab came with his servant from Madinatul Munawwara. They are coming towards Sham. When they come towards Sham, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu does istiqbal. You know, he comes to collect him. It was a time of the servant to drive on the mount whilst they were entering. And Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab to hold the rein because they were taking turns. So Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. And you know what he did as well? He took off his shoes and he put them under his armpit. And his clothes were patched. And he says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, ma hadha taf'aluhu? What are you doing? You know what he said? And plus, you know, you should be on the mount because you are going to the dignitaries of the Jews and you will get the handover of the key. He says, لَوْ غَيْرُكَ قَالَهَا يَا أَبَا عُبَيْدَى لَأَوْجَعْتُهُ دَرْبًا. If it was anyone else but you, I would have reprimanded him. And I would have made a sample out of him for the people to come until the day of Qiyam. He said, and Umar blasted someone upon this. And then what did he say? كُنَّا أَذِلَّا. We were a disgraced and a debased community. We had no value in the days of Jahiliyyah. Sayyidina Umar says, my father used to say, you are going to rule when you don't even know how to graze animals? To make janwar charana ni ata, and you think you're going to rule the world? And that same Umar radiyallahu, he says, mahma ibtaghayna al-izzah bighayri ma a'azzana Allah adhallana Allah. He says, as long as you try and gain honor and dignity in anything but what Allah Ta'ala has placed honor and dignity in, you will always be humiliated. So this is another thing as well. And the last point, inshallah, in times of fitan and difficulty, if you can't do anything, then just stay at home. Stay at home. What did Rasulullah say? There will come times of fitan. He says, Al-qa'id fiha khayrun min al-qa'im. Wal-qa'im fiha khayrun min al-mashi. Wal-mashi fiha khayrun min al-sa'i. The person who is sitting down is better than the one who is standing up in that fitna. Person who is standing is better than the person who is walking. And the person who is walking is better than the person who is running towards that fitna. So at the times of difficulty, what do? You resort to your house. Sayyidina Rasulullah, you know, when Sahabi came and said, Messenger of Allah, what do I do in that time? When the time of fitna that you are saying happens, what do I do? Rasulullah says, تَلْزَمُ جَمَاعَةَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَإِمَامَهُمْ. Hold steadfast to the jama'at of the Muslims and their imam. Oh, Messenger of Allah, if there is no jama'at, there is no imam. What did he say? What did Rasulullah say? In that case, you become like the mat in your home. You know the mat in your home? You place it there, welcome mat. Okay, the welcome mat. You place it there, and then what happens? You just leave it there. You become like the mat at your home. Mulla Ali Qadi rahmatullahi in Mirqat says, the time that we are living through, this is, you're looking at 500-600 years ago. Mulla Ali Qadi says, هذا زمان السكوت وملازمة البيوت والقناعة بالقوت حتى تموت. This is the time, the best person is who? The one who remains zipped. Zaman al-sukut, when you remain quiet. وَمُلَازَمَةُ الْبُيُوتِ, stay at home. وَالْقَنَاعَةُ بِالْقُوتِ, you remain content with whatever Allah has given you until you die. And inshallah, I'll just finish on this last point, inshallah. The hadith mentioned by Sayyidina Uqba ibn Amr radiyallahu anhu, mentioned by Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi, when he said, O Messenger of Allah, مَنْ نَجَاتِ. How will I attain my salvation and my success? What did Rasulullah say? The three things. أملك عليك لسانك, control your tongue. وليسعك بيتك, let your home suffice you. You don't need to, you know, people just, in order to kill time, they run into Westfield. These are places of fitna. You know, they say it's boring at home. So what do? You go and you see, mashallah, astaghfirullah, fitan after fitan after fitan in Westfield. Why do you have to go when you don't have to buy anything? If you could buy something from the local shop, why do you have to waste your time and go there? These are places of fitan. What did Rasulullah say? The best places on the surface of the earth, أحب البلاد إلى الله مساجدها وأبغض البلاد إلى الله أسواقها. The worst places are the markets and the best places are the masajid. Stay in the masjid. Stay at home. Look after your families. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the understanding and the realization to realize the fitan that we are going through, and accordingly, inshallah, strengthen our iman, become people of knowledge, attain our knowledge, learn our religion, preach our religion to others, inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will keep us steadfast. At these times, make excessive dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow us to remain firm at times of hardship and fitan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us all away without having involved us into any fitna. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to meet Him at a state where we are happy with Allah. Allah Ta'ala is happy with us. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.